March 21st, 10 a.m. in Burleson, Texas at Graceview Baptist Church. It's where we're going to have our Doctrine and Devotion Southwest Conference. It's going to be awesome.
Conference.
You want to be there because we're going to talk about how to protect orthodoxy while promoting unity. In other words, how to contend for the faith without being a jerk face.
Oh, that's good right there.
Now, for more information, go to doctrineanddevotion.com. Look at the banner. Click on the banner. Register today. Space is running out. It's going to be awesome. We'll see you there. Welcome to Doctrine and Devotion, a podcast exploring Christian faith and practice from a Reformed Baptist perspective. My name is Joe Thorne. I'm the lead pastor of Redeemer Fellowship in St. Charles, Illinois.
And I'm Jimmy Fowler, executive pastor at Redeemer Fellowship.
Cheers.
Cheers.
How you doing?
I am doing good.
Oh, that sounded like a little like a Reformed pub throwback. What? Did they do that cheers thing on? Remember Reform Pub? Remember there was a podcast called the Reform Pub?
The Reform Pubcast?
Yeah. I don't remember what it was called. But yeah. Remember Wes? What's his name? Wes?
Wes.
Lester?
Les
Lanford. I'm joking. So Les and Tanner.
Tanner,
yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I think didn't they do the cheers thing? We weren't trying to copy.
I think they did like cheers and amen.
Yeah. Well, we don't have to Jesus juke this thing. We just say cheers.
We're okay with just the cheers. Yeah. Jesus accepts the cheers.
Yeah, cheers. You know, prost, whatever, l'chaim, whatever you want to say.
Yeah, we're enjoying that Basil Hayden with these. Oh, I love these.
These glasses are cool.
These are so good. I still might not buy them.
You know what? Those will look good on camera.
I know. I love them.
These are great. So how's your day going, man?
It's going good.
Yeah. Busy day?
Yes.
Hey, I hear you have to go out of town again.
Yep.
Yeah. When's that happening?
I was going to bring that up towards the end here.
Okay, well, I'll wait. I'll let you bring it up at the end.
Then. No, it's fine. I'm heading to Leeds.
Leeds?
Leeds.
Where's that?
North England.
North England?
North. So north of London.
Nobody knows Leeds. You should say you're going to North England.
No, there was a great show there. By the Who.
Oh, goodness.
Live in Leeds.
No, the Who is pretty cool.
Yeah.
I'll give you that.
Yeah.
All right. A little before your time, but okay.
Yeah, but nonetheless, they still talk about it.
They do.
And there's stuff all around about it. Nah, man. Great community. Great city. Love it. Enjoy it. Business, yep.
Vacation too?
Nope.
No, just business.
Just business. I'm just going to fly in. Well.
No, you're going to be gone for a while because we have to record a bunch of episodes.
Yeah, I know, but I'll be for a week. I leave on a Thursday.
Yeah.
Right? So that means I arrive on a Friday.
Yeah.
And then I'm there. I'm going to a Leeds United match on Saturday.
Boring.
With some employees. Mm-hmm. Sunday, going to go shoot down to London for to go see Brad and Julia.
Okay. What church are you going to go to on Sunday then?
I'm hoping to go to Brad and Julia's church.
Okay.
They go to Trinity Church down there. So right. I'm hoping to be able to make it. I just got to make sure I get there on time.
Yeah.
It's a 2-hour train ride. So it depends on how. Either that or usually I go to Sheffield. I take the train to Sheffield and go to, I believe it's called the Meeting Place or Meeting House. Do you know? It's an 829 church. What's his name?
Crowder.
Is it Crowding House?
I don't know.
No. It's going to kill me. I can't remember his name. Timmis.
Oh, Steve Timmis' church. Steve,
yeah, so that's where I usually go when I'm in town.
Nice.
You thought you had me there,
didn't
you?
I thought I was going to get you. I was going to get you for not going to church.
I know where the churches are that I go to.
Where are you? When are you coming back? You leave on a Thursday. What day do you come back on?
I fly back the following Thursday. So I got to...
it's 2 weeks. You crossed into the second week. Counts as two.
So, yeah. Sunday, meetings, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, fly out Thursday morning.
Yeah, cool. Well, my wife is going to be leaving in September. It's a ways off, but she's going to Corsica. Well, she's going to go to Germany.
Okay.
Meet up with her mom and her sisters.
Yeah.
And then they're going to go to Corsica. They got just giant Airbnb.
Man.
They're going to be on the beach. Is that a French island? And it's a beach. I know that. Anyway, they're going to be
chilling. What month are they going?
Like September, I think. I don't know. So it'll be like 70.
I'll probably be out that way in August for a month.
Yeah. Well, it's, she's taking my daughter, Catherine.
Well, wow, dude. Okay. First of all, you would hate it.
What? I don't want to go to the beach. Yeah.
Yes. Would hate that trip.
The beach
and would hate you being on that trip.
Well, I wouldn't be on it's like the beach is like the closest you can get to hell. It's hot.
What?
It's dry.
What?
It's just the abyss you're staring out into. Like, who would want to go to the beach? It's crabs everywhere biting your toes. I'm not going to the beach, man. Sharks. No, thanks. Not doing it. I'll go to the pool under an umbrella.
And just sit there with your cigar.
With my phone and the cigar.
And your hat. Your vacation hat.
Beach is the worst.
Your pasty white legs. I've seen them.
Oh, yeah.
My Jen legs, sends my me
legs
photos.
My legs look good.
No,
yeah, they do.
They're pale.
Yeah, but they're not the color. But the shape is good. They got a good shape to them.
Okay. What do you I'm going to look for that photo Jen sent me.
Yeah, you can. I'm not ashamed.
You're not ashamed?
No, you here should. I stand.
You
I
should.
I can do no other. I show my legs.
Oh, no, you could. You could it tan.
Nah, that's why my skin's all smooth and soft. Mm. Yeah.
So, man, that's going to be fun for you. How was your day going?
Good. Getting a lot done. Getting really excited about the conference in Texas and very excited about the 2020 Chicagoland conference.
Yeah. Are you getting a lot done because you're reading Every Day Matters?
I am. You know, that's a biblical approach to productivity.
Yeah. You know what? They just sent me this.
Yeah. They just sent it to us.
So I have not read it by Kent Hughes.
Yep.
You know, I am excited though to reread Help My Unbelief by Pipes.
Yeah. I'm excited to look at that too. I can't reread it because I haven't read it yet. But it's a new edition.
You didn't read it?
No, I ain't got time to read about unbelief.
Wait, it's revised and expanded?
Expanded, yeah. Much more unbelief in there. That's what it is.
Now with twice as more unbelief. Yeah. 30% more unbelief,
yeah,
y'all.
Yeah, just like, what do they call it? Raisin Bran. Yeah.
No. You know, here's the thing. When they revise and expand these things, how is someone supposed to understand, like, if you reread it, right, how are you going to know the difference?
All right. For example, we're going to talk about Don Whitney's book, Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life. That's been revised and expanded.
Yeah.
And he did that because at some point he realized, like, you know what? I didn't address enough gospel issues in here because, you know, somebody could take this. And if they're not really grounded in the gospel, maybe they could have a warped perspective. So I think that was why he revised and expanded it. And it's sort of like The Life of God and the Soul of Man is a book that is really, really good, but it doesn't have a ton of Christ in it. And I would imagine that that would be a good book to revise and expand.
Yeah, yeah.
If it wasn't a few hundred years old.
Yeah, for sure.
So, All right. So what we're going to do today is we're gonna do a real episode.
A real
episode on the spiritual discipline of solitude. Silence and solitude.
I'm pretty sure we've done this once before, didn't we?
Yeah. What's funny is, okay, so if you guys don't know, back in 2017, on April 1st, we released a bonus episode on silence and solitude.
We held on to that one because we started so thinking great of that in like January.
That was your idea. You came
January,
up with that.
February, we're like, you'll be a great podcast joke. And we sat on it.
So we recorded it. So if you go and you listen to that episode,
we recorded it.
It's there's an intro that lasts, I don't know, a minute or two.
Mm-hmm.
And then we say, so we basically introduce the discipline of silence and solitude. And then there's just quiet for like 30 minutes. So,
we do the ending.
And the ending, there's an ending to the end. And people were writing us going, dude, your podcast is messed up. There's nothing. It's just silent. Exactly. Way to pay attention, bro. It's April 1st. See, we don't do the obvious, like super obvious. It's just funny.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So, yeah, it's still
the best part was, though, is that we inserted 30 minutes of silence so that if someone would sit there and scroll back and forth and they would see, like, they wouldn't see it was only 2 minutes or 3 minutes.
Yeah, then they'd know the joke.
Then they're going to know the joke.
Yeah. 30.
30 minutes of silence.
Yep. And then it's, let's see here. Yeah, 32 minutes and 33 seconds. That's the episode length.
Awesome. Listen, when we troll hard.
Yeah, you know, creatively, it was good. But this is a real one.
Yeah.
We want to talk about this discipline of silence and solitude, emphasis on the solitude.
Yep.
And really, what we're drawing on is Donnie Whitney's book,
Spiritual
Disciplines for the Christian Life.
My good. Have you seen his handwriting? Have you seen his penmanship?
Yeah, man. I've got a book autographed by him from like 1994, and his penmanship back then was all like crazy. He's older now. I don't know. Might have gone downhill a little bit.
No, I doubt it. I bet you. I think he's like a fine wine. He's a fine wine. His
Donnie Whitney is a. Is he a Cabernet?
He's a yes, yes. Whitney's a Cabernet.
What would you be? A port?
Because I'm portly.
No, because it's got more alcohol.
No. You know what? I would actually.
You'd be champagne, you dandy. You totally would be champagne.
I was thinking something like rich and dry, but like got the like a little flavorful
Pinot Noir. I don't know.
I'm like the Taronga grape.
I'm
from
Ripple.
The Campania region of Italy, southern Italy. That's what I am.
I'm the cheap wine. I'm the bottom.
You're wine in a box.
Yeah. Well, some wine in a box is pretty good. Yeah. There are high end wines in boxes now. Mm-hmm. Google it.
Yeah, I'm not. Now I have to throw away my computer because I don't want that search history.
It's worse than having porn on your computer. Cheap wine search. Your wife would be like, I can't believe you were searching for cheap wine. Yeah,
my wife would leave me.
Yeah, she'd be like, this would cross the line.
But like, we love Donnie Whitney. We love his book. We love the spiritual disciplines for the Christian life. And as Joe mentioned, it was recently revised and expanded to kind of go deeper. It's a fantastic resource. Really great book. I highly recommend reading it every few years.
Yeah, it's good.
I know some people read it every year. I have not done that.
You're not that weak, yeah.
No, it's not that. I'm not that.
You haven't forgotten what Bible intake is.
So Joe, for you, as we, you know, we love this book. We've talked about this. We've promoted this book, and we don't get paid to promote that book.
Nope.
Why do we think this book is so important?
Because we tend to think we have the spiritual disciplines, either we tend to think we haven't figured out, like, oh, I read my Bible and I pray and I worship, but we don't often think very deeply about them. And so Whitney goes deep into these disciplines to help you understand what's at stake, how to do it. So it's practical, it's theological, it's very biblical, and he covers a multitude of spiritual disciplines, which are, I think, really good. So it's a good introduction for new believers. It's also a good refresher for the mature Christian who just needs to start rethinking about them, because again, we tend to get comfortable. But it's also just good instruction, because like I said, even experienced Christians may not think about all of these disciplines like silence and solitude. They might not think about that from a biblical perspective as a discipline that they should engage in. And so I think it opens up Christians and readers to disciplines that they haven't considered before, while sort of stoking the fires to get back into what we take for granted or tend to slip out of. I know that's happens to me. So yeah, it's good for me to go back and reread it. And I love recommending it. It's not like super complicated, right?
Yeah.
It's easy to read. I mean, Whitney's really smart, but he's able to write like Sproul was like that. Sproul could just write at that level for everybody. Everybody can read. Anybody
the fofo level.
Book. Yeah. Not the McCoy level. Steve still could not read. No way. Steve needs help.
McCoy's a whole nother level.
Whenever Steve reads a book, his finger goes along the lines of each of the words. He has to.
Yeah. I don't do that.
No, of course not.
I don't have a ruler that I.
You're Jimmy Fowler.
Yeah. I don't do that.
Awkward.
It is. So Joe, like when we talk about like discipline, or really the discipline of being solitude, what are we talking about?
Well, Whitney says that solitude is the voluntary and temporal withdrawing to privacy for spiritual purpose. Very general definition, but it means getting alone and getting with God. That's how I would say it, right? Getting alone and getting with God. And really, if you're talking about the discipline of solitude, it should accompany the discipline of silence, right?
Yeah.
You not talking, but you listening. We'll talk more about that in a little bit.
And I think what's really important, though, as we're looking through this, and I love that when you're voluntary and temporal withdrawing to privacy for spiritual purposes, right?
Yeah.
And I tend to withdraw to privacy to avoid. And that's not what we're talking about here. We're not talking about it's not a spiritual discipline to avoid your circumstances, to withdraw to avoid your circumstances. It's
or
not
to just sulk.
To have a little pity party.
Curl up in the fetal position on your bed because the girl that you liked in college said she couldn't talk to you anymore because your past was too messed up and her dad would never accept you. That might have happened to somebody I know.
You might have been, you know, some others that they're... You went to your future father-in-law and asked about dating his daughter and with the intention of marrying her. He says, no, you're not good enough.
Yeah.
And I know, people from Chicago just can't be, and you look thug, but you know, I know I'm not thug. Yeah. You're sitting here. I'm with my nice jeans and
your goatee,
shirt
and youth pastor goatee.
And you know, and tells you you're not good enough.
And when people experience these kinds of things, they tend to curl up in the fetal position.
So I've been told.
Yeah. I mean, I've heard testimonies like this. That's not
what we're talking
about.
That's
being a baby.
Yeah. So we're not talking about avoiding circumstances. We're not talking about withdrawing for privacy because you want to avoid, you know, hard relationships or people that you're in conflict with, or just to skirt your responsibilities.
Yeah. Yeah. That's laziness, apathy, fear. Those are not good reasons to isolate yourself. However, the discipline of solitude is good to prepare you for those circumstances, yeah. right? So like, oh, yeah, yeah. I just got the anvil dropped on my head and I'm feeling weak, but instead of just curling up and whining and crying, I'm going to go and be alone and be with God and let God do his work in me. I'm going to yeah. seek him in the midst of that. That's yeah. really the idea.
And so, Joe, like when we look at scripture, we see some examples.
Got some silence and solitude.
I mean, Matthew 4, right? Mm. Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness and he was alone there for 30 or 40.
Well, he wasn't alone. Devil was there too for a while.
He was alone there for 40 days, except for when the devil came to tempt him.
Yeah, and the devil tried to screw up his silence and solitude.
Yeah, see?
He was not having it.
Nope, he was not. He was not. Matthew 14, right?
Mm-hmm.
After he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone.
Right. Mark 1:35 says, rising early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. Happens yeah. all the time. And I mean, this was a thing that Jesus regularly did.
Yeah.
When it was day, this is a Luke 4:42. When it was day, he departed and went into a desolate place. So Jesus is obviously giving us an example of yeah. this discipline of solitude. And I know that there are some critical reviews of Donnie the Man's book. They don't, I've read some really I'll be honest. I think they're garbage reviews of his book, where they're sort of nitpicking and saying, "Well, Jesus isn't an example for us in all of these ways." And Jesus certainly isn't an example for us in everything that he did. He didn't get married, for example,
yeah.
and so yep. that's not a prescription for everybody. But his life of discipline, submission to God, his walk with the Father, those are examples for us. And so this is an example. Jesus doesn't yeah. just serve as an example for us. His righteousness is our salvation.
Yeah.
But it is then also a model for us to emulate.
And then he explicitly calls us to practice it.
Where?
In the Bible.
Okay.
Yeah, Matthew 6:6. But when you pray, this is Jesus, but when you pray, go into your room and shut the door.
Shut the front door.
Shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret.
Yeah. That's pretty clear, right?
Yeah.
Like, get alone and get with God. This doesn't mean public prayer is bad.
Nope.
Public prayer is good. Corporate prayer is good.
Really good.
It's
yes.
important
essential.
That we get alone. And I just know experientially, I think most of us know that there can be a true sweetness, a reviving influence when we do this right. And we'll talk about yeah. what that means when we do this right. Sometimes you need to get alone.
Yeah.
But sometimes, Jimmy,
oh.
you need to get with the people.
Yeah, and you know what? Specific people. You need to get
the best people.
You need to get with the JOFO.
You know what happens? Bad company corrupts good morals. Paul said that.
Paul said that. Okay.
Yeah, but you get with the JOFO and the listeners of D&D in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Sanctification.
When can they do that, Joe? When can they get with us?
Well, March.
March 21st.
Is it March 21st?
Burleson, Texas.
10 a.m.
It's going to be Graceview Baptist Church.
A one-day conference. It's going to be awesome. Jimmy and I are really excited to talk about contending for the gospel, how to protect orthodoxy and promote unity, how to contend for the faith while loving your brothers and stiff-arming heretics. Got to stiff-arm the heretics.
You got to stiff-arm.
But you want to be able to
those still, inside and outside. Yep. Yeah.
But you want to embrace the brothers and sisters, even yep. when they're erring, and try to have a relationship with them. So we're going to talk about that. We're really excited. You can go to doctrineanddevotion.com and register. Space is limited because Graceview is a tiny little baby church. They don't have like 1,000 seats like we need.
I'm pretty sure theirs is bigger than ours.
Oh, it's way bigger than ours.
What does that mean?
We got a preemie sanctuary. We like nothing in there.
They're baby, we're preemie.
Yeah, yeah. Graceview, man, great. Let me just say about this at Graceview. I was at Graceview and Grace, I've never said this before.
Oh, never.
The people at Graceview?
Oh, here we go.
Those are my people.
They remind you of what?
Redeemer Fellowship.
Oh, and if you are not serving at Redeemer, where?
I would kick Scarborough out and be the lead pastor.
You say the same thing.
I do that. What are you talking about?
You talked about it with Michael Beck's church.
Okay, that's definitely true with Michael Beck's church.
Speaking of which, Anthony sent me a message. We got to talk about it.
Oh, cool.
So you said it about Beck's church.
Yep.
You said it about just the whole city of Portland.
No. I just said
I said
in Portland,
yes,
everybody looks like
did.
Me.
And now,
that's what I said.
Burleson, Texas.
But that church is really great. Mm-hmm. Solid pastors, mm-hmm. solid people.
Mm-hmm. I'm not saying people. They're not. I'm just saying, you just seem to say the same thing.
I don't say it. Don't say it about Andy Stanley's church.
We haven't been there.
How do you know?
Oh, when was the last time you were at Andy Stanley's church?
2000.
And doing
right
what?
When he planted.
Doing what?
Being commissioned as a missionary within the North American Mission Board. What's up?
Okay, you win this round.
I don't know if I was actually at the church, though. I just know it's in the area. It's in the area. It's in Alpharetta, Georgia. So I know, you know, it's in there somewhere. I don't know. I wasn't really paying attention. All right, man. So listen, let's talk about why solitude is important, right? Like getting away.
Yeah.
Because like we live in a crazy day. We are always, people are always working. They're sort of always on call with cell phones and internet and all of that. Did you see the download speed I got now?
Yeah, oh, I was so jealous.
I sinned.
Like I was jealous. I was envious. I asked the Lord, how is it that you gave it to him and not me?
Yeah, well,
because my download speed's at 20.
Because I've got 7 people streaming at the same time. That's why God gave it to me.
But I got like 25.
You 25 down?
Yeah,
that's what we had. We're supposed to have 30 down, and we were getting like not very much. So yeah, 300 and something down. So anyways, with all of the internet and all the distractions, and while in many ways we aren't as busy with work as previous generations were because we have so much automation and help and technology, we tend to fill our time with busyness, and there is a constant pressure to always be on and to always be connected. So solitude is a disconnecting and an isolating of ourselves for spiritual purposes. So what are some reasons that this is helpful for us when we do that, Jimmy?
Well, I mean, just right there, you talked about just all the technology around us and how busy things can get. All the, you know, when you have 300 download speed, that means you're watching certain, you know, watching a bunch of videos and movies, TikTok and
doing the TikTok on five phones at the same time.
Wait, did you say downloading movies?
Yeah.
Downloading, like, what do you mean?
So like Amazon and on Netflix, you click download. Mm. So it downloads to your device. Yeah, okay. That way I can sit in my car and smoke a cigar where I don't get the internet and I can watch it there. Okay. Yeah. You thought you were going to catch me torrenting or something. I don't do that.
Anymore.
Never have. I have never torrented.
Well, okay then.
There you go.
All right. So
try and catch me.
I did try. Yeah. So it removes distractions. Going alone, it's important because it removes all those distractions and it's just you, the word, and the Lord.
There's just noise everywhere, man.
Yeah.
And it's like, and you can see it, right? Like when, I don't think this is true with you, but I've traveled with a lot of other people in the past, pastors in particular, and we would get into a hotel room, and the first thing they do is they turn on the TV. They got to have the TV on. And I was always like, and not that I'm so spiritual I wouldn't do that. I would play music or something. Mm-hmm. But I was always like, it was just obvious, like, wow, I would never want to turn the TV on in here. And I would ask them about it, like, I just got to have some noise. Like, there's this awkwardness when it's too quiet. Like, we're so used to noise and busyness and sort of this electronic chaos that when we don't have it, we don't really know what to do. There's like TV shows playing in the lines at theme parks, right? Because people are standing in line for too long. You get bored. They got to have some sort of distraction.
I don't think the hotels you and I stay at have TVs that
work.
Not
the last one.
Not the last one.
Jimmy is so bougie that he stays in really nice hotels. And if they don't serve Eggs Benedict, it's really not going to be a hotel that he stays at. But he tried to keep it on the cheap and went to California. And it was,
I went way too far. The pendulum really shifted.
Oh, man. I'll stay in a divey, scary place. This one
had a crackhead outside.
Crackhead outside yelling at us.
She was yelling at us.
Like, she didn't have any clothes on. Like, what's going on?
No, she had clothes on. That's
not
weird.
All of her clothes.
Oh, she looked away.
Yeah,
no, I was trying not to laugh.
I was fixated. It was scary.
So we want to remove these distractions.
Yeah, crazy crackheads.
But it also provides an opportunity to worship, right? When you're alone, there's this opportunity for you to worship with God and just to have that opportunity.
Yeah, and I think about it, like, you know, maybe you'll sing, maybe you won't, but the point is that you have the opportunity to consciously, intentionally adore the triune God who loves you. You can think on him and meditate on him. And that, like, that's another thing that it gives us the opportunity to do. It provides an opportunity to seek the Lord, right? Like, think of just, like, we get up, we get going, we got all this stuff to do. Most people today in our culture, you know, rich people culture, you know, we get on our phones. It's the first thing. We wake up, boom, grab the phone off the nightstand, and like, what are my social media, emails, like, what's business, like, whatever it is, people want to go to it right away. What are the newest TikToks that have been happening? They go to that stuff right away, and we just kind of fill up our days with all of these things. Solitude gives you the opportunity to say, like, you know what? I'm going to push everything aside, and I'm going to worship God and seek him intentionally. I like that. It also, I got a couple of other, what do you got?
I was going to talk about how it forces us to be still. Like, it forces us just to quiet down, still, and rest, right? Yeah. And like you mentioned before, this go, go, go culture, just that opportunity to just
Yeah, we need it, right? And like, there's not a lot of rest. People feel guilty.
Yeah, and it's a rhythm. It's a natural rhythm that we really need in our lives.
It's almost like God should have, I don't know, said, hey, like every week you should take a whole day and just rest.
Oh yeah, yeah, you know? Yeah, yeah. I mean. And I figured he also told us, like, at least every month go on vacation. And that's what I'm trying to do.
And every day have a siesta, Jimmy?
I sometimes.
Yeah. Or once a week, go down to the boat.
That used to be like
that. I know, that was a thing. That was your business got way too busy. That ain't happening anymore, I noticed.
Yeah. Boat Fridays and barbecue boat Fridays no longer.
I brought back a memory for you, didn't I?
Yeah, you did. Yeah. I missed that, man. Yeah, we'll just go, take phone calls, Jimmy barbecue, like, and sleep.
Jimmy would be like, hey, man, you want to drive down to the Lake Michigan and go hang out on the boat all day? And I'm like, no. I want to stand on a boat all day. It's not a boat all day. He's like, because it's fun with barbecue. We eat and we hang out. I'm like, oh, that's kind of cool. Do I have to be in the sun? Can I sit in the shade? That was my biggest concern.
Yeah. Well, there was
the water. The sun reflects on the water and it burns your skin.
I mean, there's a living room and three bedrooms on the thing.
So I can hang out. Is it air conditioned? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Invite me next time.
Yeah. It's up in Nova Scotia right now.
Oh, then forget about that. And another thing that it does, why this is important, is it helps us to regain a spiritual perspective on things. Like Jimmy was talking about earlier, like when he's being a big baby because his father-in-law was being mean to him.
No, I'm not saying it was me.
Somebody was being mean to somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
That, he sort of caved in on himself and just cried all day. But when we do face difficulties or stressful situations, when we're confused or concerned, anxious, angry, whatever it is, getting away and spending time with the Lord helps us to regain a spiritual perspective. If you're doing it right, we're going to talk about how to do it right here in just a minute. But because again, it's like you're not just getting alone and just sitting there and sulking or stewing or getting mad. You've got a very specific spiritual purpose when you're doing it. And so, yeah, it can help you to get clarity on what God is doing, certainly what God's word says, and what you should do as you're filling this time with the right disciplines that as an accompaniment.
Yeah. And so when we talk about doing it right, I think it's fair to say meditating on scripture is not just important. It's a necessity.
Yeah. You're not doing solitude right if the word is not a part of it.
Yeah.
It may be one verse.
Yeah.
It may be
one opportunity.
One chance.
To seize everything you ever wanted.
Mom spaghetti.
Never forgetting.
I don't know the rest.
So yeah, I mean, yeah, like you said, one verse, whether it's one chapter.
It could be a theological doctrine even from the word of God that you're thinking about. It doesn't really matter. What matters is that it's the truth of God that you are bringing to bear on yourself in that time. In fact, I came across this quote by David Mathis. He wrote about this discipline on desiring God. And one of the things he said is, solitude is a kind of companion to fellowship, a fasting from other people to make our return to them all the better.
Mm.
Silence is a fasting from noise and talk to improve our listening and speaking. But God doesn't mean for us to fast long from food, fellowship, noise, and talk. And there's nothing in Scripture that would lead us to think that he would have us ever fast from his word and prayer. In fact, it is for increased engagement with God's word and prayer that is at the heart of good silence and solitude. David Mathis killed it on that paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
Really, really good stuff. So, Jimmy, like, obviously, if you're doing silence and solitude, maybe give up your phone.
Oh, yeah.
I would say give up, turn it off, put on silent. But I can't have it with me. If I'm really doing it, I gotta put it away. I got to turn it off or turn the ringer off and literally just put it in my bag or something. So I'm not, because if it's there, I will pick it up. It's just,
I
got to pick it up. And I would even say no music. Now, you can have, of course, like, listen, there's no rule that you can't have music. Music can be great, but it's also, music could be a distraction for you. It's definitely, I think, a good habit to make time for yourself to be in true silence without anything. Now, it may not be possible, right? Some people are in a stage of life or in a station where getting alone for any real length of time is just not likely. I mean, it's like there are some people, I know some stay-at-home parents, like they're just like, when are they gonna, there's like little kids everywhere always all the time, and they're gonna take a nap, but then they're gonna cry in the middle of it. They're not gonna really be there. They're not gonna really give them the opportunity to be alone. So maybe you do have some noise canceling headphones that you put on for a little bit. Mine are Skull Candy. What kind of noise canceling headphones do you have, Jimmy?
Bose.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. Is it the Trump version? They're all like gold lined.
Don't worry about it. What are you going to do? Trump, why do you do Trump, this to me? Why do you do this to me?
Trump by Bose. That's what you got. Yeah, I mean, like, do whatever it takes, right? Yeah. And do it to the best of your ability. But now Whitney makes some suggestions, right? When he talks about this in his articles and in his book, what are some of his suggestions that he makes if you're going to engage in this discipline?
He talks about minute retreats, right? Mm. So just having these little opportunities, and you kind of prioritize these small segments of the day where silence and solitude can be achieved. So I think it depends on your season, what works best for you. Sometimes, you know, a minute can be achieved maybe during the lunch hour, maybe in the morning on your way to the office.
Bathroom break, hit the stall.
Yeah.
Like, seriously, like, whatever, like, find an opportunity to just be quiet and pray and consider God's word. You know, we've mentioned it here before, but I used to take, and every once in a while I'll do this, but I would take the Valley of Vision and I would schedule 3 times a day, usually like around 9 and 12 and 3, when my alarm would go off, and that would mean go get away somewhere right now and meditate on one of those prayers from the Valley of Vision. And that was a little minute retreat that Whitney is suggesting. So however you do it, it's a good idea to try it, right? Just try it. And if minute retreats are not going to happen unless you schedule them, you got to, for most people, you got to make it happen. We're too busy. And then if you think like, I'll do it later, if you don't schedule it, I'll do it later, I'll have more time later, and you'll never do
You'll never get
Just
to it.
Just put it in your phone and make it ring. And you're like, okay, now's the time when I'm going to do it. We're not talking about a long time, just a couple of minutes.
60 seconds.
Yeah, just go and do that thing. One of the things that he said was to set a goal of daily silence and solitude. And this is just old school, do your devotions, right? Have a quiet time, whatever you want to call it. You know, I'm a big believer in doing it in the morning for most people. I think most people would benefit from doing it in the morning, but not everybody can do it in the morning. So whether you do it in the afternoon or in the evening or both, right? Like the psalmist, in the morning and in the evening. Mm-hmm. But yeah, set a goal. It's not a legalistic goal. You don't have to beat yourself up if it doesn't happen, but it's a good idea to just make it a part of your routine. You know, and I know when you and I are firing on most of our cylinders, that's something that's happening, right? Yep. That's not the first thing to go. We really try to protect that because we need that time alone with God. I know, like, if we don't have that, we're not oriented. We're not thinking straight. And I know that if I take the time to meditate on God's word and pray and get alone with him for a short period of time in the morning, it sets me up for the rest of the day. And I'm generally more inclined to have those thoughts continue with me than if I didn't have it at all.
Yeah. I think there should also be trying to set that goal of daily silence and solitude, right? Like making sure you do it.
That's what I just said.
Huh?
Yeah.
No, you said, we were talking about the minute retreats on that one.
Nope. Set a goal of daily silence and solitude. That was the second one. Now his third one is what, Jimmy?
Oh, well, you know, his plan. I was like totally paying attention
to you. No, you were not. You were totally not. You were on your phone. You're looking at stuff. I saw you looking at stuff. You be present. You be in the moment. This is not your time of silence and solitude. This is your time to be with me in fellowship. Come on, man.
You were like, set a goal.
I'm not going to look dumb this time. You literally said that before we got it. I'm not going to look dumb. I know what we're doing.
I hate you.
I got this outline here where Whitney's suggestions here, these four suggestions from Whitney.
I went through them. I'm good. Anyways, number three, plan a day or more to getting away. And I think this is more than just retreats. I mean, retreats and conferences are great, but I think this is something like, those are great opportunities, right? And they have their place, right? But often I find when I do go away and involved in a conference or retreat, I do come away tired, right?
And a
bit exhausted.
There's like thousands of people there.
Yeah. Well, not ours, but yeah.
No, that's why ours are refreshing.
Yeah, that's why ours are refreshing. Yeah. It's not thousands. But I think I
Nicholas Batzig is calling.
Oh.
Want me to put him on speaker?
Yep.
All right, hang on.
Oh, this is going to be good.
Hang on. Hey, Nick Batzig, we are recording right now, so you are being recorded on speaker.
Oh, that's awesome.
Hey, Nick.
Hey, guys. Are y'all really recording?
Yeah.
You're on our episode on the discipline of silence and solitude.
Oh, that's awesome.
I think he wants to...
Is this sponsored by the Babylon Bee?
No, they're not sponsoring us yet. We'll see. Right. We'll see. Hey, can I call you back?
Yeah.
Thanks for calling me, Nick.
He doesn't have your number.
I'll call you, Jimmy.
Bye, buddy. He ain't calling me. All right. So, sorry. Plan a day, like we said, to get away. It can be exhausting at conferences. So, I hate being away from my family. Like, that's
yeah, you
true.
Do. Yeah.
I do hate that.
As much as you travel, I know it. That's why you take them with you whenever you can.
Whenever I can, I try to take, I try at least take my wife with
yeah,
me. Right?
Yeah. Forget the kids.
Yeah. That's true.
You ain't got time for that.
So, but. When I'm going on this trip alone, or when I go on trips alone, as much as it I hate it, there is that opportunity where I'm able to be by myself, right? So I always try to build in a day when I'm not doing work at all.
Now, but most people aren't one percenters like you, Jimmy, so they can't.
I hate you. I hate you so much. I hate you.
So. People,
I'm like 3%.
Okay, you're 3%.
I'm at 3%.
I'm exaggerating.
I'm just saying,
funny.
If we're in the U.S., you're at 5.
Okay. Yeah, I think we're all kind of qualified as rich in America. If you got a cell phone that's a smartphone, you rich.
All right. Anyways, go ahead.
But if like some people like the idea, like, oh, I'm just supposed to go like find a log cabin up in Colorado and just like be alone. No. You can have a day alone. Listen, go to the library. Go to the library, get a cubicle. And just be alone.
Yeah.
Or there's places, you know, go to a park. There are places where you can go where you can actually make the most of it. Some people will just like, hey, I'm just going to go and rent a hotel room and just hang out. And I'm just going to pray and read my Bible. And that's
and
it.
Maybe take a nap.
Naps are good.
Yeah.
Naps
sometimes good. People need naps.
So but I think it's a good idea. Try to plan a day or more to get away. Now, I don't do that. And I'm not speaking hypocritically here because I'm not pretending to do that. I need to do that. I need to find a way to do that. And there are multiple ways that I can do that. I need to do it because I think that would be really good just to refresh. And I've known pastors that have done this where they will, and we've done it here at Redeemer. We'll take all the elders and we'll just go to like a house somewhere and we'll just spend a day going over church and just dreaming about and praying about the future. But for individuals to do it, I think it would be really, really good.
Well, what else, Joe? What would you say?
Well, Whitney also says that you should find or create a special place. And this could be as simple as, you know, like just a small corner in your house somewhere that's a dedicated space, or maybe it's a gazebo in the backyard if you're Jimmy Fowler.
Stop! Don't have a gazebo.
You don't have a gazebo. I know. Yeah, he has a marble lined
stop
patio chandelier hanging over it.
Here's the thing:
you got a champagne fountain.
People came to my house. They would be
you're like, why is the house black but the bricks are orange?
I hate
that's
you.
What they would ask.
I hate
like,
you so much.
Kind of a weird house.
I don't want
to
talk about my house. It's so ghetto.
It is not ghetto. It's very nice. I think it's a very nice house.
Oh, yeah, but no chandelier.
Yeah. Except when you go into your bathroom, dude, you've got a picture of your children naked in the bathroom. That's weird.
No, it's not weird.
That is a
okay,
weird.
Okay, it is weird. My wife put it up there. I know. Yeah, it's weird. It's weird. So
Canadian
I
thing.
Think, Joe, what's really important, as Whitney says, to kind of wrap everything up, I'll jump onto this last one.
Yeah.
So Whitney says for the last one, you want to find or create a special place.
Yeah.
And so it's really important that it, you know.
It's another thing you can do.
It's exactly.
I think that, you know, people like, you know, maybe there is, I mean, this isn't exactly the same thing, but even just like, hey, there's a booth at a diner that I like to go to where I'm just by myself, right? Yeah. And so, no, there's people around, so it's not exactly the same thing. But find a special place if it's possible at all. That could be a means to make you go, I like going there, you know? So, listen, we're recommending Don Whitney's book, Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life. Go get that. We got a link for it in the show notes, so go over there and buy that book. By the way, if you buy that book through Amazon, they give us like a penny. So
help us get a penny.
If a million of you buy that book, it's like $1 million.
Yeah. Sure.
Is that what that is?
No.
I'm not good at math. You're,
yeah. It's okay. Good job.
But get the book anyways, because it's really good. I don't care who you get it from. Get that book. Check it out. And we would like to hear your favorite spiritual disciplines, right? So maybe it's not silence and solitude because you're too much of a tech addict and you're too much of an extrovert and you can't handle being alone because when you look into the abyss looks back into you and you don't know what to do with yourself and you lose your identity and you want to despair. Maybe that's you. But what are your spiritual disciplines that you tend to really enjoy? And maybe like, hey, what are some that you're looking forward to getting stronger in the new year? Jimmy, how do they do that? How do they share these ideas with us on the social medias?
Yeah, you can follow us online on Instagram and Twitter at Doc and Devo or on Facebook /Doctrine and Devo. You can head to the website, drvotion.com. There you can contact us. You can sign up for the email blast or hit up the store, jofostore.com, and grab some gear. Fresh pod every Monday and Thursday. Blog post on Wednesdays. Are you calling Nick?
I'm calling Nick. I gotta call Nick.
Later.